Hello, BookTube. I am here to tell you what I've been reading since we last met. This is going to be kind of crazy because I've read quite a bit. It's been quite a while since I made a video. Again, I've mentioned this before. If you follow me on Instagram at Terry Talks Books, you'll have seen pictures and sometimes a little commentary on most of these, if not all of them. Yeah, there's probably a few that I didn't put on Insta, but I've gathered them all together from the four corners of the house and put them in one big pile. In fact, that should be my thumbnail, is just a picture of that pile. It's sitting next to me over here. And I'm going to have to hold myself in check a little bit because there's just too many. If I start rambling and wandering off like I usually do, we'll just be here till kingdom come. So don't want to keep you that long. So anyway, let's get started. And I don't know, I didn't go back and look, but it was probably sometime in the spring that I made my last video. So, this is what I've been reading since earlier this year, let's say March or April. I don't even remember. Anyway, I will hopefully have posted a poetry reading, a short poetry reading before this. And yes, I'm wearing the same outfit because I just recorded it. And anyway, that's a little collection of poems that I've been just opening up throughout the year and reading out of. I don't know quite why I suddenly had this need, but the poetry reading is the first poem, the foreword and the first poem in How to Paint Sunlight by Lawrence Ferlinghetti. And I didn't talk too much about the author, the poet, before reading to you in that one. But for those of you who don't know, I do believe he was considered a beat poet. Anyway, he goes way back because he was born in 1919, in March of 1919, and he passed away just 2 years ago, really, in 2021, February of 2021. So he was just a month shy of 102 years old. So he had a very long life, and maybe it's because I'm getting older, but I found his poetry, especially in this collection, as an older man, these are poems between 1997 and 2000, more lyric. They speak differently, and I'm guessing that's age. And the man was a painter. He wasn't just a poet, he was a painter. So How to Paint Sunlight kind of addresses, oh, just many things. We've got some titles: The Changing Light, Yachts in Sun, Big Sur Light, The Light of Birds. Oh my. Are There Not Still Fireflies? I like that title. Just so many. And I got to hear him do a reading out of this collection in 2001. And it will just be one of those things that happen in your life that you just don't ever forget. So I am very glad I met this icon, and I'm very glad I met him when he was quite aged. So anyway, I'll stop on that. So this one is kind of a, I have read, I'm still reading, and I don't know, just till the end of the year, maybe I'll just keep on reading. So let's get on to this pile over here. These are not in order that I read them. I've kind of grouped them a little bit. And the first group is, these are books that all of them were very fast reads, very just, you can read them very quickly. They'll hold, you know, they hold your attention. I enjoyed them. I enjoyed them all. I can't remember what I rated them all at this point, and I didn't make a list. But generally speaking, they're going to be 3 and 4 star ratings. And for me, as I've mentioned before, if I rate something on Goodreads as a 3-star, then I enjoyed it. There's, you know, I could sit and critique it, but why? And most of those kinds of books are not the type of book that I'd really want to tear apart anyway. It's not the kind of book I would do an analysis on, and, you know, critique the writing or structure. Really, you know, sometimes these things pass through my mind, but they're not really appropriate for this type of book. Not for me. Somebody else might do that. I don't know. So the first two I'm going to mention are by the same author, Sylvia Noble, and she writes a series called The Kendall Odell Mysteries, and there are 6 of them. I think this is 4 and 5, and I just have one more to read. So I have Seeds of Vengeance, which I just flashed at you, and then Forbidden Entry. So these all take place in the Southwest, Southwestern United States, specifically in Arizona. I don't think she's left. I don't remember her character leaving Arizona. So they're regional mysteries. They will hold your attention. They are written from the perspective of a journalist working in a small town, a small burg, I was going to say, in Arizona, near the Bradshaw Mountains, and anyway, out in the desert, and, you know, sometimes we're down in Bisbee, sometimes we're in Prescott, sometimes we're, you know, just in this general area. So they are fun. They have a bit of a romantic element, because, of course, she has, you know, the really good-looking boyfriend, and, you know, they, you know, ride horses together, and there's always misunderstandings, of course. And you gotta have misunderstandings, but you know they're gonna stay together. They're gonna make up at the end and stay together. So, of course, he's very good-looking rancher, you know, the cowboy hat, the, you know, the boots, the horses. It's awesome. Anyway, so read those two. And then I caught up on my books about Port Danby by London Lovett. And these are, I guess I'd call them another regional mystery. It takes place somewhere on the West Coast. I haven't really gotten a clear sense of where this is. And in fact, I read quite a few of them before I realized it was a small town on the West Coast and not the East Coast. I'm not sure why I thought that it was on the East Coast, but I did, made an assumption. So Lilacs and Liability, another very quick read. And this one here has Lacey and her boyfriend, James. And Lacey is, what was she before she moved to the small town on the coast? An opened flower shop called Pink's Flowers, because that's Lacey's nickname, is Pink. And let's see, she meets, there's kind of 2 guys in the earlier books, and now we're down to just the one guy, James, who happens to be, I think, the police chief. So, and the typical, you know, there's a murder that needs solved, and, you know, it's another character like in the Sylvia Noble books here, always getting herself in trouble trying to solve a murder. These small places, talk about the number of murders. My gosh, it's like watching a Murder, She Wrote. It's like, you know, it's an author who lives in this small town. That one, I think, was on the East Coast. and is like the percentage of murders for that happen in this tiny little place that, of course, you know, our main character there, she names are eluding me right now, but anyway, she, you know, she's always inserting herself and helping to solve the mysteries. It's a thing, okay? It's a thing. Set aside the disbelief there, just, you know, and go with it. They're fun. They're a lot of fun. So anyway, this one's Lacey and her boyfriend James, and she solves mysteries. And there's one of her friends is a baker. She has a bakery right next to the Lacey's flower shop, and so she can sometimes, often, always smell the yummy baked goods. You know, they kind of, the smells waft over through the walls, air system, whatever. And so, you know, sounds so nice. So of course she's always tempted, and her baker friend comes over and tries out, you know, whatever she's recently baked. You know, Lacey gets to get free treats all the time. Chewy chocolate walnut cookies. So there's always a recipe that shows up in the book somewhere. In the back of the book. So that's kind of a delightful little bit. So if one is like really wanting some chewy chocolate walnut cookies after reading the book, because, you know, that's what London Lovett here does a good enough job. She does an excellent job. She makes you want to eat these yummy things, okay? So thank God she provides some recipes in the back, because, you know, after, well, you might not even get to the end of the book. You may have to go make some cookies. So anyway, so now I'm ready for the next one, which I think is something with the word poinsettias in the title that will be coming out. If it's not out already, it's coming out soon. I think it'll be kind of a Christmas-themed murder mystery. So we'll look forward to Lacey getting herself into trouble and her her man, James, the police chief, giving her what for, because she always gets herself into the middle of these murder investigations. Okay, next, I got myself all caught up and finished with a series of books by Lucinda Riley that some of you might be interested in. It's called the Seven Sisters series. And I had three books to get to completion. And I'm kind of glad I had these to read after the last one came out, because you just get to, it's like, you want to know, it's like, they're all tied together, and there's going to be one reveal at the end. So we have seven sisters. These take place over, how do I put this? These are all girls who have been adopted by someone named Pa Salt. And they all have been given names by Pa Salt that align with the Pleiades. So the seven sisters, the stars, the star system. And so if you, the better you know your mythology, the more clever maybe it seems. So anyway, each one of the books goes into one of these sisters finding out about her past, because they don't know their past. In fact, Pa Salt is a mystery, and he dies. You know, this is not a secret. He dies, and he leaves clues for them in order to find out their past. So each one of these books, and they're all huge, they're just huge. How many pages is this? 630 pages. So for this one, but they read really fast. You'll get through them pretty quickly. And they're this interesting blend of a mystery, a historical fiction, because each one of these girls who are now women, they have to go somewhere in the world to find out their history, and they dig into it, and so you'll find out about something regionally there. Sometimes there'll be names of people, real people, and real events. She takes liberties, obviously, with the actual historical accounts, but there are real historical figures and real events in these books, and I find them fascinating, and they're quite an interesting way of, you know, kind of getting a peek at some historical person or event or a thing, and, you know, whether it has to do with art, music, dance, pearl diving. it's absolutely fascinating, and you're all over the world throughout this. So what did I read? I read The Sun Sister, which is the last of the sisters we know about, and her name is Electra. All of them have the last name Diabolis. And eventually you catch on that these names are, what do you call it when you mix up all the letters? Getting old. You mix up all the letters. So if you look at Diabolis, it actually spells something else. It took me a while to catch on. I felt kind of, you know, I was kind of head smacking when I figured out some of them. I'm like, okay. So I got pretty good at figuring out those little puzzles, letter puzzles, and getting to some of the mythology in the names. So anyway, so this one, Sun Sister, Electra Diabolis, and the historical element here takes place in Africa and in 1939 New York. So there's a time spread here, and it doesn't stay in 1939, but we get this time spread. And anyway, just, it was just lovely. Anyway, these are, oh my gosh, these are just suck you in books. Then the last one, so we have seven sisters, right? Well, there's only six that we know about. Then there is the missing sister. Who is the missing sister? Well, if you know your mythology, that gives you a little clue of what maybe name you're going to come across, and all. So I read The Missing Sister. So this completed the story of the sisters, and we finally find the missing sister. Yes, we do. But it took how many pages? I think the author planned on wrapping it up and letting us know who Pa Salt was and solving that mystery for us. But she's got 798 pages, and we just barely got through The Missing Sister. So there was an additional book. What would that be? Eight books, I guess, then. This one is Atlas, The Story of Pa Salt. So it's the story. It's the big mystery. Who was this man? Well, if you're good at moving some letters around, you might be able to figure that out. And if you know the story of the mythology, the seven sisters, you know, the Pleiades, you might have figured some things out before I did. Anyway, you'll see that there are two authors here, Harry Whittaker. This is Lucinda Riley's son, and he's on here because he had to take her notes and what she'd already written. And so there was, you know, this is still her story and the way she wanted it to end. But he had to finish it because she passed away before the book came. She didn't get to finish writing it. And 2021, she died in June 2021. So anyway, I think he did a very good job. This would be so hard to do. And he wraps it all up for us, and so you can feel satisfied at the end. So there was that. Just that was alone. Finishing that up was quite a page commitment. Then, okay, the next thing I'm going to do is I am going to talk about books I read kind of per season. I do like to do some seasonal reading, and I mess with that a little bit. But one of the things you may have heard me talk about before is I like to read science fiction in the summer. I don't know what it is. That's when you're supposed to read science fiction. Okay? Got it? So I finished up something I've had forever and ever and ever and ever. This is The Summer Queen by Joan Vinge. Joan D. Vinge. And I'd read The Snow Queen by her, which precedes this. Two times, three times, second time, and maybe third time. Anyway, I'd read them, I guess maybe only two times. I read The Snow Queen because it'd been a while, and I wanted to read that again before I read this one. And finally, this time around, I said, you know what? I need to get this read. This has been on my shelf forever and ever and ever and ever. And I enjoyed The Snow Queen so much. So it was a little bit disconcerting because there was some stuff that got explained. You know, it's just, they do flow one into the other, but you can have that separation. I don't know as though I'd say read this before Snow Queen. I think I'd say read Snow Queen. Okay, just read Snow Queen and then read this, and it's going to make more sense. So I had to keep kind of going back in my memory and filling in the blanks, and you know, fortunately the author put enough in here to refer me back. So I was like, oh yeah, that happened, and that kind of explains where we are now. So delightful. I think I preferred the Snow Queen over this one here, but this was just a bucket of fun. Just a total bucket of fun. I enjoyed it. So if you like that, it's kind of fantastical. It is, I think, something that's found in science fiction, but science fiction and fantasy often get put together. The publisher on this, it's labeled science fiction, at least this ancient copy I have. And it was Warner Books, I guess. So anyway, the sequel to the Hugo Award-winning novel, The Snow Queen. And then this one, The Summer Queen, was a Hugo Award nominee. So it didn't win the prize. But anyway, but as you can kind of see from the cover, you know, masks play into this. There's a festival. The world we're in is, the seasons are very, very long. The years are very, very long. And so it doesn't quite, and there's lifespan longevity things going on there that I can't remember if it was explained at all in The Snow Queen, but definitely in this one, you find out what that's about and why, you know, the long life and looking young for so many years. And so anyway, just a lot of fun. And if this sounds intriguing, and I think the mask thing was more prominent in The Snow Queen, and I just loved it. I found it fascinating, the making of masks and something that represents the person wearing it. So there are things about this mask that represent the person wearing it, and you know, it's a master mask maker who, I don't think I'm spoiling anything, plug your ears for a second just in case, if you don't want to know, but she's blind. I found that there's a little twist in that, but she makes these absolutely gorgeous masks for people, and of course, you know, being able to match it to, I guess, you know, she's drawing out the inner person, really. So I really enjoy this. This, if you go look at what people have to say about it online, it's going to be all over the map. So are there people who just like, meh, didn't like that. It was maybe the only criticism I could say is I don't think it needed to be quite this long. And the other book was probably half the length. This is over 900 pages. What are we, 930s, 40s? 948. We're not done. 949. Yeah, 949 pages. And the Snow Queen, when you put them together, they look about the same size, but there's something about the paper, maybe thickness, or it's not super thin paper. This is almost double, I think, of the Snow Queen. So I don't think it needed to be quite that long, almost 1,000 pages. But it'll read fast. You know, it'll read pretty quickly. So completely doable. Okay, so that was a summer read. And then I read this one, Red and Gone by Alison Brooke. And I like to do this little Christmas in July thing. And so this was sitting around on my shelf. I hadn't gotten around to it at Christmas time. So it's a mystery. There's a ghost. It's a cozy. Let's see here. There's a cat. There's a boyfriend. She helps solve the murder, of course. Oh my goodness. In a small town, again. She's a librarian. Yes, that's where the ghost comes in. There's the ghost of a previous librarian. It's kind of precious. Again, super fast read. And I had fun. There's a, you know, kind of, it takes place at Christmas time. So there's a little Christmas stuff going on. There's Christmas things happening at the library. And oh, there you go. There's the cat. We can't see the ghost, but there's the cat. And the character's name in this is Carrie Singleton. And anyway, another fun series of books. I think this is just the second in the series. And I know there's more out by now. This one's copyright 2022. So there you go. That was fun, in case you're looking for something like that. Let's see here. Then I went off on this little jaunt, a little nonfiction jaunt here, and read Lake of the Ozarks by Bill Geist. I think that's how you say his name. My Surreal Summers in a Vanishing America. And Bill Geist was a correspondent, CBS Sunday Morning correspondent. I don't think I'm familiar with this person, this man. Anyway, on the back, he shares laugh out loud anecdotes and tongue-in-cheek observations guaranteed to evoke a strong sense of nostalgia for the good old days. Now I'm going to come back to that because I have something to say about that. So it's called Lake of the Ozarks. And yes, I do believe it's at a lake in the Ozarks, if I'm remembering correctly from... when did I read this? August, I think in August. And it is very, there's a little bit of a giveaway here. My Surreal Summers in a Vanishing America. Yes, a Vanishing America. And you'll see that there's some, you know, old photographs in here. Some of the girls who lived there at the lake and worked in the restaurant. Sisterhood of Servers. So, you know, they kind of had cabin dormitories and, you know, this is back in the, looking at it, was the 50s or 60s, both. Anyway, people used to go to camps as families, and, you know, it was, and stay in cabins, and there were pre-planned activities, you know, if you've ever watched Dirty Dancing, you know, that, it kind of makes me think of that a little bit as far as, you know, the setting and what's going on at the camps and all of that. So yes, it was nostalgic, and I enjoyed this, but it's not really the kind of nostalgia that I thought I was going to get and that I tend to look for. which is a little bit of a more sweet nostalgia, I guess, is one way to say it. This is pretty in your face. Good old days. Put that in quotes, the good old days. He takes a little harder and harsher and more realistic approach, I would say, to his nostalgia. So it's nostalgic, but he doesn't soften the things like, you know, drinking too much and just some of the stuff that went on, you know, the smoking, the drinking, I'm not sure how to put it. I should have talked about this, of course, closer to the time that I read it, and I probably would do a little bit better at that. So it's worth reading, but go into it knowing that you are not going to get sweet nostalgia. There's Uncle Ed. So anyway, I enjoyed it. It's a very fast read. So if you're looking for something like this, and it is maybe a more realistic slice of what America was like in the 40s, 50s, early 60s, and things like, I mean, these places are gone. They're gone now. And they have things put up in place of these more quaint cabins and lakeside cabins. They're a lot more shishi, bougie, you know, resort-like. Anyway, that was fun. And then I did a buddy read of short stories, again, with the science fiction. I did the buddy read with Britta Bowler, and it's Her Smoke Rose Up Forever by James Tiptree Jr., and I'll let you look up who James Tiptree was. Hopefully you already know. But anyway, it was a collection of short stories. These are, as typical with collections of short stories, some you're going to like, some you're not going to like, some you might not even understand, may have to read them more than once. In fact, she has quite a few in here that would benefit from a reread, I thought. And, you know, there's social commentary going on, as is usual. It is definitely worth the reading. I would suggest for most people to spread this out. Read a story, maybe two, come back later and read another one. We kind of read this through in, I don't remember how long we took. Was it 2 weeks? I don't remember. We took several weeks, but it still, I was overwhelmed. And they're not nice. They're not nice stories. And so it weighed on me. Weighed on me some. And she gets into some things that are more feminist. Anyway, it was just, some of them were just harder. And so it would have been better to sit it down, spread this out. I'm looking forward to going back and rereading many of these, and just like pick one of the stories, reread it, and then go off my merry way and come back at some future time and reread. I might look at the table of contents and leave myself, you know, check off the ones that I've reread already, so I'm not duplicating necessarily. So, very good, very worthwhile, but just go in prepared that they're not nice. May need a break. Okay, so then I got into some stuff during the fall. September, October, and I had this on my shelf, The Fortnight in September by R.C. Sheriff. Absolutely delightful book. I read it in September because September, and our characters go to the seaside in the, gosh, what were we in? In September, It's a story, it's a novel about ordinary people enjoying simple pleasures. And it is, it says, delightfully nostalgic. Yes, delightfully nostalgic. It was written, copyrighted 1931. So I'm guessing that's maybe the time period around there, maybe the 20s, the 1920s. And this is in England. Were we in Cornwall? I don't think we were in Cornwall. It wasn't Cornwall. They arrive in Bognor and check in at Seaview, the guest house where they always stay. They've been doing it for a long time, since the children who are now adults. There's a son and daughter. They're adults, but they've been doing this since they were the son and daughter were children. So they've been doing it as a family. Mr. Stevens, the Stevens family. And, you know, Mr. Stevens takes long walks, reflecting on his life, his worries and disappointments. And so, it's just a pleasant read. And, you know, the thoughts of the characters, and there's no great plot going on here, but I thought it was kind of delightful character studies, character thoughts, character interactions, in a nostalgic setting. So I really liked it. I'm looking forward to reading. I have something else by R.C. Sherriff. It's one of the, let me see. Do we have a list of his other writings in here? Yes, no, 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 no. Let's see, he wrote a play. Let's see, he was born in 1896, joined the East Surrey Regiment early in World War I, wounded in 1917. He wrote plays, Journey's End. Let's see here. He did scripts for The Invisible Man. 1930s. He worked on Mrs. Miniver. He worked on Goodbye, Mr. Chips. And the one I'm trying to think of is the Hopkins manuscript. He wrote that. That was a novel. He died in 1975. So born in 1896, died in 1975. And I enjoyed his writing. So I'm looking forward to the Hopkins manuscript. Then, because I, you know, read the flap on that, I saw that he contributed to the movie Goodbye, Mr. Chips, which I've never seen, and now I need to see it. But what I did was pick this up. This is a lovely fall read to me. Goodbye, Mr. Chips. Yeah, you'll cry. Very short, very short. How many pages? 120 pages, and you can see lots of white space, larger font, and so you'll finish that. Most people can probably read this in in one sitting. So, Goodbye, Mr. Chips by James Hilton. Lovely, encourage just about anybody to read this and get your Kleenex box out for the end. Okay, just saying. And then I read Farewell Summer by Ray Bradbury. It's another book that I have had on my shelf for a very long time, and lovely, and inside cover and pages. The book itself is delightful. The naked book itself is delightful. Is this one of my signed copies? No, not a signed copy, but this is 2006 copyright. This is a follow-up to Dandelion Wine. I would read Dandelion Wine before I read this. I would. You don't have to. You do not have to. But I would. Dandelion Wine is my favorite of his. It's pretty nostalgic. And I think of Ray Bradbury, almost all of his writing, as narrative poetry. It's very poetic. I get along with his writing really, really well. Love Something Wicked This Way Comes, which is I really encourage you to read it in October. I like that book. I liked it a lot. And then Dandelion Wine, I think when he went to have that published, that this was kind of a continuation of sorts. And they said, no, take it out of there. And he just worked on this over the span of his life. So Dandelion Wine goes way, way back, decades back. And so he finished this up and got it published as an old man. And so it gives it just an interesting feel of an older person who has gained wisdom and understands life and Farewell Summer. Should give it away. And what he did at the end surprised me. That's all I'm gonna say. I just went, ah, Ray. As only Ray could write. Interesting metaphor. That's all I'm gonna tell you. You gotta read it for yourself. Anyway, very poetic and beautiful. I read this very, very, very quickly, and you will have a sense of nostalgia from this, as you would maybe with Dandelion Wine, is all. You're old enough and maybe have some experience with people who lived in the Midwest in a small town in the 1920s, 30s, 40s. You don't have to have lived it yourself, but I'm old enough that I've experienced it by going back to visit relatives who are no longer with us. They grew up like that. So, and a lot of that world just, it still existed. So I recognize it very, very, very much from, especially my childhood. So there you go. Highly recommend that. Then I had an interesting experience. I started this nonfiction history book only yesterday, An Informal History of the 1920s by Frederick Lewis Allen. And this was published in 1931. It covers the history of the 1920s. So that's what's interesting about this book. He lived it and he wrote about it like right away, the 1920s, that published 1931. So it gives a very interesting historical perspective, I think, to read history soon after the history has happened. It's just a certain type of look. I thoroughly enjoyed this. It took me way too long because I put it down and picked it back up. And I read this at the suggestion of my mother. This was used in a history class that she took. This and the book Since Yesterday, I do believe, which covers the 1930s. And he published that in like 1940 or something like that. In a history class she took in the 1970s, this was the assigned reading, this and Since Yesterday. So, if you're interested in history and historical perspective, and you're interested in the 1920s, United States, 1920s, I would recommend this. I really would. It's not hard to read, and it's just incredibly interesting. So after finishing this book was mentioned, and I go, I have that book. Of course, I have that book. Have I ever read it? No, I've never read it. It's All Quiet on the Western Front, the greatest war novel of all time by Erich Maria. I've been told how you say that. He's German. He was German. Remarque. In my head, I always, Spanish name or something. I didn't guess French. Excuse me. I didn't guess German. And it's written from a German perspective. Really gut-wrenching, really tells you about World War One and the almost the barbarity of it, you know, the trench warfare. And I don't know if I'll ever read it again. I'm glad I read it. It's very good. It's very well done. And I had to keep, it's so universal in experience. I had to keep reminding myself that this is from the German perspective in World War One. Okay. Not American, not French. It's German. Okay. So again, highly recommended if you're interested, but be prepared. Gird your loins, people, because sucker slammed me to the ground. I couldn't read for a week after that. Okay, and then we're getting into Long Run. Thank goodness, because I'm over 45 minutes, y'all. Oh, good heavens. I should have split this up. The Sanatorium by Sarah Pierce. I'm not going to say much about it. It was decent. I think this was her debut, fairly recent, and I didn't connect with it well. So it's a mystery suspense. Yes, there's murder in an Alpine Swiss, I think, are we in Switzerland? I think it's Swiss, a converted sanatorium into a resort of some kind. There's an avalanche, there's people stuck in this place, there's multiple murders that are quite bizarre, but it felt very cold to me. I never attached to any of the characters, didn't really care that much about them. So I don't know if this author has found her mojo or not. It's okay, you know, but I don't know. I don't remember if I gave it 2.5 or 3. I might have given it a 2.5, but I mean, it'll entertain you if there's nothing else to read. I hate doing that, but I had higher expectations for that. And this was another buddy read with Britta a while back, The Witch Elm, Tana French. This is not one of the Dublin murder mysteries. This is a standalone. It was pretty good, I thought. I'm trying to just read all of her books, and that's something that Britta and I did, what was it, last year? We were working on it last year, and it bled into this year. I still have to read The Searcher. She's already read The Searcher. And so I guess I might have been getting, it was refreshing because it wasn't the same trope that she uses in the Dublin Murder Squad books. And I think I needed a break from that. It's still clearly Tana French, but it was very enjoyable. I enjoyed it very much. And I don't remember what star rating I gave it. This one I read way back earlier this year, May, maybe in the month of May. And I did a separate review of it, so I'm not going to belabor this one. The Murmur of Bees, which is a translated work. It's written by Sofia Segovia. And it's translated by Simon Bruni. It was beautiful. If you want to know more about this, go back and just listen to me go on and on about this beautiful book. Anyway, loved it. I think I gave it 5 stars. I must have given it 5 stars. I must have given it 5 stars. Anyway, absolutely loved it. And then the last one, home stretch. Can I finish this before 50 minutes, maybe? Is a graphic novel. It's a bind-up of 3 Aya, Life in Yop City by Marguerite Abouet and Clément Oubrerier. I will get that in there so you can figure that one out for yourself. I do not speak French. I attempt to say things properly and probably fail miserably most of the time. So, but the first one I think is correct, Marguerite Abouet. And this is 1970s Ivory Coast. Ivory Coast, 1978. It's a golden time and the nation, an oasis of affluence and stability in West Africa, seems fueled by something wondrous. Aya is loosely based upon Marguerite Abouet's youth in Yop City. It is the story of the studious and clear-sighted 19-year-old Aya, her easygoing friends Ajua and Bintu, and their meddling relatives and neighbors. It's a wry soap opera revolving around the simple pleasures and private troubles of everyday life in Yop City. I loved this. I think, there you go. Here's some, a quick glance. But I really enjoyed this. And I think there's another bind up with three more. And so I haven't acquired that one yet. And so I finally got through all of this. I'd read volume one as a standalone. I checked it out from my public library years ago when it was quite a bit newer. And then did not manage to get my hands on additional volumes. So finally bought this bind up, sat on my shelf for a while. What do we got here? Entire contents copyright 2007 is the first one. So we got 2007, 2015, 2017. So maybe that's the copyrights for each of the volumes that's in here. Anyway, I don't read a lot of graphic novels. It's not my thing. I enjoy this. And getting to get a glimpse of, you know, some, you know, Ivory Coast in the 70s when a lot more middle class. I don't know how things are there now, but I don't think they are the same. So anyway, it's kind of a look back. And anyway, that I'm just like running really long here. So I'm going to just stop now. And hopefully I won't wait as long before you see me again. I will be back at some point with my birthday book haul. I'm not quite done book hauling for my birthday. So I'll have to come back and do that one. But birthday was, you know, this month in October. I tend to celebrate for the whole month, especially when it comes to buying books for myself, acquiring. Sometimes people give me books. Yes, they do. So anyway, I will see you again soon, BookTube. Bye-bye.